first got into mixed martial arts, I was boxing prior before I started to this. And there's actually a boxing gym below, Next Gen. I started boxing in there, went from amateur to pro, and got took on by a few of the lads downstairs. One thing led to another. Paul used to have a few of the lads from up here go downstairs and obviously train with the boxing, get their hands better and defence and stuff like that. And then just one day, bumped into him. He asked me to come upstairs. It was more or less like a little bit of a gamble, kind of like to put on my toes and said, got a couple of lads upstairs that are like the best ones in the gym and like, see what you can do, come up, train with them and see if you can stay on your feet on the mat. So came up, done it, enjoyed it, and then I've just stuck at it since then.
I was always obsessed with like Jean-Claude Van Damme films and Steven Seagal films as a kid. And then when I was about 15 or 16 years old, a friend of mine's brother had a copy of USC, the Ultimate Fighting Championship 2. And it blew my mind, you know, because you grow up seeing like action stars like Arnold Schwarzenegger or whoever, like big muscular guys, obviously big guys, you know, taking on several guys at one time or whatever. And then when I saw this video of the VHS of UFC 2, there was a guy called Hoist Gracie who must have weighed about 175 pounds, and he defeated three guys in one night in less than 5 minutes. Submitted them all, and every one of them outweighed him by a good 20 to 40 pounds. So I suppose it was the first time that you got an opportunity, or it was the first time that I got an opportunity to see martial arts working in a real environment. Because you always see these movies with kung fu guys, maybe a little guy takes on all these different opponents, and that doesn't really work in the real world. I'd done some Thai boxing as a kid, and when I saw Hoist Gracie use Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu to submit someone, blew my mind. And from that day forth, I was obsessed with Jiu-Jitsu and obviously with getting involved in mixed martial arts.
Since I was five, I was never into football, never into anything other than martial arts and fighting, really. So that way, I trained consistently in a lot of different martial arts up until present day. And when I was about 11 years old, there was caught a glimpse of kind of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and MMA, and from then on that was kind of all I wanted to kind of do, sort of thing.
There's loads to learn within MMA, and you're talking like seven different areas of mixed martial arts. You've got to learn specific things, and then you've got to sort of connect them all together so the transitions run fluent and stuff like that. But it gives you a good foundation. You have your doubts and your fears and your worries and stuff like that, but they kind of get put aside with sort of dreams, aspirations, and ambitions of where you want to be, where you want to go. You're kind of always visioning of who you're going to be, the reason why you're in there for the first place, the reason why you put yourself through so many hours of training and sweating and bruises in the gym. And it kind of just all comes together. It overwhelms the nerves, the little bits of fear or any insecurities or doubts that you have, and you go in there feeling nice and strong, and you're focused on one thing, and that's just to come out with a win.
That's the biggest thing. You can put any of the other attributes that you would think would make a successful athlete into any situation. It's always going to be the person that wants it the most. And that doesn't always necessarily mean that they're the best person in the room. But eventually they will be the best person in the room. That's how I always look at it with a lot of the guys that come here. You can tell the difference between the guys that want to be a champion and that are hungry for it, and the guys that are just going through the motions.
I had a bit of a mad upbringing and stuff like that, and came from some rough areas and that. And I had my fair share of problems, you know what I mean? And one thing that it's taught me is a lot of discipline. Respect.
I spend a lot of time with these guys. I'm with them all day, every day, 6 days a week. And when I go home, they're still texting me and ringing me and asking me stuff. It's something I don't switch off from. In the role I am, I take full responsibility for everything they do.
I think it's good for focus more than anything. If you've got a lot of physical energy and stuff like that, and you put a lot of focus and time into something, you can only respect yourself for what you do, do you know what I mean? And you can hold your head high. Gives you a lot of confidence, and obviously for younger adults and obviously use and stuff like that is a good thing to have. Get confidence in your flying, you know what I mean? So, yeah, I'd definitely advise anyone to get into it because it's a good thing to have. You've got self-defence, you're fit. Everyone should be doing fitness. Your health's a massive thing, you know what I mean? Obviously, prolonged life. So, yeah, I'd advise anyone to do it.
Hi, I'm Alex Cook. I've been training now to be a professional wrestler for the past 2 years, and I'm just going to see what MMA training is all about. I decided to be the one to take part in the training session because I felt that, no offence to the others, but I thought I'd gain a lot more from it than them. I thought I'd be a lot more fitter than them. I suppose that sounds a bit like a backhanded sort of criticism, but I was really up for it. I wanted to see how the sort of MMA style trained and prepared for a fight, and the only way you can really see that is firsthand. For me, the most surprising thing was into the sparring and how draining it can be 5 seconds in. The amount of stamina, it's not power or anything, they've got their technique and they've got their power, it's the stamina to keep on going for, I think they do 3 3-minute rounds or whatever. I was done 15 seconds in. It takes a lot more than just power to become an MMA fighter, and that's on the first lesson.
I got to about, I'd say about 24, 25, and then I started having real issues with my body with regards to pain in the joints, repetitive injuries in my neck. I had a lot of problems with neck and spine to the point where I couldn't sit down and read stuff for a long period of time because I got constant shooting pains in my neck.
The easiest way to put it is you can put too much sort of safety into it, where it takes that excitement element out of it, which then makes it the number one combat sport. So it's kind of like now that at most people are getting cuts and stuff like that. It can be a bit gruesome when you see blood and stuff like that. But like I say it isn't like it's two thugs going in there and fighting. They're both athletes, both trained. Your bodies are conditioned to take more anyway and stuff like that. And ultimately, it is safe. There's a ref that is in the cage from start to finish. He's always looking down, observing the fight, watching for any weaknesses, any signs that somebody's ready to go or at any given moment he's ready to jump in. So, yeah, I'm happy with the safety of it. Like,
frustrated with the changes of opponent, but it didn't matter in the end.
It takes a toll on the body, especially when it comes to the ground fighting side of things, because you might be put in a position where someone's like got hold of your neck and they're really squeezing hard, but it's not a proper submission hold, it's just uncomfortable, so you kind of won't tap because your ego gets in the way and you don't want to submit to something like that, to a headlock basically, or neck crank as we call it. But the result on that is that your body falls apart. Something's got to give, and it's usually the little guy's body, unfortunately.
It depends on the kind of toll that you think that MMA takes on your body, because there's different sorts of tolls. There's repeatedly getting punched in the head sort of tolls, and then there's the toll of kind of wrestling every day. The question that you should ask is, do athletes worry about the long-term effects of their sports?
If you've got heart and determination, you'll fight to the bitter end, do you know what I mean? It's like, I've got that mentality myself. Like, I like to go in there and think that I'll fight to the death, do you know what I mean?
Do you know there was a study where they asked 100 athletes, if you could take a pill that would put you at the top of your sport, but you would die within 5 years, would you take the pill? I think something like 95% of them said, yeah, they'd take the pill.
There's more highs than what there is lows as well, so, and the highs are massive. The wins from fights, coming in training, like saying you've got good partners to be with and friends and family and that, do you know what I mean? So, and I'm doing something that I love. I get to come to work, the gym, and it's enjoyable, do you know what I mean? So I can't grumble at that.
Ultimately, I want these to realise the dreams, you know what I mean? So, my dream was never to be a UFC champion. My dream was to train a UFC champion. That's the difference. So they're helping me with my goals as well. When I first started coaching, I wrote down 5 goals that I had for myself, and I've hit 4 of them. I've hit 4 of them. And the last one left is to train a UFC champion. To be honest, it doesn't have to be a UFC champion, a world champion on an established show such as Cage Warriors or UFC. You know, that's the last goal that I had of my own personal coaching goals. You know what I mean? All the others are done.